I feel like I'm doing things, but nothing's getting done in reality. Like, I'm not moving forward. I'm just wasting time. I don't know.
I want to go to school, and I want to get an education, but I just hate school. School's not for me. Like, I don't know. It's just not for me. I want to do something that I like.
And there's the weight issue. Like, you should be glad of who you are, but it's hard to completely do that.
What happens if my life doesn't get better, you know? What would I have to look forward to after that?
And it sucks.
What the hell is the point?
God.
So, that's it.
It's a crazy world out there. Who knows what's going on? The media tells us we're powerful consumers because we have expendable income. And yet, most of us are barely getting by on lunch money and a couple extra bucks. We've been told by parents and teachers that junk food's unhealthy and we shouldn't eat a lot of fast food either. But that's what they serve us at school. And our parents seem to be so busy that they bring us the fast food. In 2004, the movie Super Size Me showed us what happens when a middle-aged guy eating a bizarre diet of only McDonald's for a month got sick. But what would happen if we took a look at real kids in real environments going about their normal day? We're gonna tag along with some of these kids. We'll bring experts into our house. We'll take a look at what's really going on.
Hey Liz, it's Mom. I'm on my way to pick you up. I have your blankie, your box, your cough drops, and wait for me out by Symphony Hall. Love you, and I'll see you in a few minutes. Bye. Call me when you get this message. I hope your cell phone's on. Turn it on when you get out of school. Okay, bye. They don't even have Melissa's cough. They have the front of her costume cut out. They don't even have her dress made, and in 2 days they go up. Oh, somebody just called on the other line. Hold on. I don't know how to do this. So if I hang up, I'll call you back. Okay, bye. Who's calling me now? Okay, I don't know how to do this. Who just called? Shoot. Hello? Ed, well, I'll just pick you up across the street from Symphony Hall, okay? At a regular time. How come you have your phone on in class? So just walk over by Symphony Hall, where I picked you up the other day. And when you come out of school, will you actually, when you come out the front door, will you call me when you're coming out the front door? Don't come all the way out, just call me when you're at the front door. Okay? Ready to go?
Yep, I'm ready.
Okay. I would like a chicken quesadilla and a crispy fish taco.
What?
Yes.
Okay.
With extra sauce and a crispy shrimp taco.
Extra white sauce.
Okay. And a crispy shrimp taco with extra secret sauce.
Okay.
Did you get that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other grievances? Huh? No, I don't have any grievances. Are you going to cry?
So I'm gonna meet Randy at the skate park tomorrow. Is that okay?
You're gonna meet him again to the skate park?
Yeah, I'm gonna meet him tomorrow.
Okay, I mean, that's what you wanna do. I'm just thinking you should mature at some point.
Man, what is it like, what's so wrong about skating?
There's nothing wrong with it. I mean, it's a bunch of 12-year-olds, and how old are you?
Do we really have to get into that? I mean, it's not the point. It's skating. I'm not going to the skate with the 12-year-olds. I'm just skating to have fun, and I'm meeting Randy. Randy's my age.
That's fine. Do what you want. You want to go skate with Randy? Go skate with Randy. Just take a chance. Don't think it's your choice. Wake up, don't you hear my voice? Don't you hear me? I swim through broken glass just to define. You left me there, free, out and swept aside.
Mammoth chip, end of February.
Yeah, for sure.
It's just really hard right now because I'm trying to find my own place with my buddy, and it's just hard to save up money, and I can't open up a bank account, so it's kind of hard to save money without a bank account.
When's spring break?
March.
Just stressed out. Yeah, basically stressed out with money.
You wanna try to go like dollar or something?
Yeah, so fun.
I have friends who eat fast food all the time. Obviously, this can't be good for them.
To start with, when you look at the size of these food items, mm-hmm. and when you look at the components, none of them fits a very balanced nutrition. The amount of sweet and the amount of fat in fast food is out of proportion. So just starting there, it's not that we're gonna badmouth fast food, mm-hmm. it's the preparation of fast food is not good.
When I look at eating, I look at the day. Okay. Do I ever eat crap, and is it okay to ever eat crap? You know what? You're going to eat crap, all right? For me to look at a teenager or an adult and say, don't ever eat crap, it's not going to happen.
Hello, welcome to Oblivion. Try our new massive meat pack.
I'd like a hamburger, small fry, and a small Coke.
That's a double cheeseburger meat pack, a large fry, and a large Coke. Would you like to try a triple grande hot fudge sundae?
I just want a hamburger, small fries, and a small Coke.
That's two double cheeseburger meat packs, two large fries, and two large Cokes, and a triple grande hot fudge sundae. That is $15.25 next window.
Shit.
If I were to offer you this sandwich, would you take it?
No.
Okay, well let me,
if you
inspect
want,
it?
Yeah, if you want to, I mean.
Okay.
You should be inspecting the food you're eating.
Yes, absolutely. Ew.
No.
No?
Why not?
Because I don't really know you.
Do you not trust me?
Not really.
No? Well, when we go to fast food restaurants, aren't we essentially trusting them and the products they put in our food?
Sure.
Yeah,
isn't that kind of like accepting a weird sandwich from someone you don't know that well?
Yeah, actually, I guess so.
Kind of weird. Since we were little, we've been brainwashed to eat the crap served at fast food places. They start shoving Happy Meals into us when we're kids and just give us the same shit when we're older, and a lot more of it. Take a McDonald's quarter pounder with cheese meal, for example. This thing weighs in at over 1,500 calories. According to the experts, we should really only be getting about 500 calories in any one meal. That means 2/3 of this thing is unnecessary junk your body will not want to deal with.
The body is a very cool thing, and it's designed so that if you're eating the right amount of the right foods, with every bite of food, automatically the energy goes to the perfect spot. Some of it goes right into your cells for fuel. Some of it goes into storage, short-term and long-term storage for later, fat, basically. And some of it stays in your blood to be ready to respond to whatever you need. But what happens is if you get too many calories, the wrong kind of calories, it confuses the signals. And before long, your body starts to tune them out. Kind of the way you tune out your parents if they're telling you something you don't want to hear and over. Yeah. And once your body starts to tune it out, you cross a line where you can't respond anymore. Your cells start to starve for energy because they're not getting the energy in there, and you get too much sugar in your blood. And that causes a lot of health problems.
And I bet that just listing the calorie content would get a lot of people switching from a large soda to a medium-sized soda.
Why don't we have this information available for us?
The food industry, the restaurant industry, opposes it. The industry is trying to prevent legislation that would make this information available in the easiest way possible, you know, right on the menu or menu board, and they're doing it because they don't want people to order smaller portions or less food.
So it's deceptive in a way, then? In a big way?
It is, and you know, one definition of deception is the failure to provide important information, and that's what they're doing.
And while we're on the subject, food companies trick us into believing what a serving size is supposed to be, and we fall for it. 10 grams of fat, and 160 calories. That doesn't seem so bad. But wait, that's if you've got three or more friends to share this with. This little package is considered 4 servings? Yeah, right. Hey Chester, you're not only a cheetah, you're a cheater. Dangerously deceiving.
Don't believe the corporations. They're only trying to milk you, so to speak, for your dollars. They want to turn you into a profit machine through foods, through drugs, through anything that they can convince you to buy. If you're a skeptical consumer and you inform yourself and you use your brain, you won't be hoodwinked by these evil corporations that I think care nothing about your health.
When you're young, you're resilient. Stuff bounces off you. You're invincible. You're the man. Nothing's going to happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the effects of all these things on your body don't happen in 5 minutes or 5 years or 10 years. But you know what? You drink that crap, not related to exercise. You eat the fast food. You do all this crap for year after year after year. And one day you're going to look in the mirror and you're going to go, holy crap, what happened?
It just catches up to you?
Absolutely. Like that.
I try to do my best, although honestly, what is do my best in school for what? I really don't know. So I can go to college, and what the hell is the point of college? So I can get a good job and pay for a house, and what the hell is the point of that? I just don't know. I just don't know.
Hey, let's see, can I get a triple grande, caramel macchiato, and a blueberry muffin?
What? What? That's a reception. I'll go to college, and everything's gonna be better. And now it's finally right here. I've already applied to colleges, and I guess I'm afraid, I guess, what comes next.
Oh, it's cool. And there's a blueberry muffin, too. Without you here, where war can't come to claim your every dream. I've mourned for the broken, the deceived. Shout if you strongly believe that this world can achieve an existence that prospers in unity. And shout if you think we can break all those.
And since the day the package opened, yearned with tattered wings to try to fly. Ache to find the strength to say goodbye to this impossible dream. Impossible dream promises everything, everything. And the sirens they sing, the sirens they sing. This impossible dream, impossible dream. Can I keep each step upon this way? Run so fast that I can't.
I don't want to screw up. I want to do things. I want to follow through. I want to make someone. I want to make my parents proud. I want to make myself proud.
This impossible dream, impossible dream.
You just want a chocolate shake, right?
Just a regular.
You don't want
chocolate.
That malted crunch thing.
Uh-uh. Just a chocolate.
Okay, I gotta get something to drink. I don't want.
Hello, can I have my take your order?
Oh, I want a bottled water for me and a chocolate shake. Small.
Sure thing. Anything else, please?
That's it, thanks.
Okay, 407, please.
Okay.
Go to bed, get ready for bed. Okay, I'll come and kiss you goodnight when we're ready.
Take a while. Night, Mom.
Night, babe. You want me to come in there and say goodnight?
I'm okay. Just want to sleep. Everything's good.
I was going to come in and give you a kiss goodnight. Liz, you got to go to sleep. We got to get up and go to school tomorrow.
Okay.
Have a
light. I'm going. Turning off the lights. Got it.
A lot of teenagers today are seemingly growing up in the backseat of mom's van, going from place to place, and almost losing out on part of their childhood. How did we get to this point? What's going on?
I think our materialism, that will to have and accumulate things, has led us to want to have more and more and more.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many factors, but what is happening is now mom and dad are working, and so they are shared responsibilities with the kids. And many ways of getting the kids to do things is by involving them in many activities. So that way they feel that their kids are getting the best out of life. And without realizing that probably the best effort that a parent can take towards their children is just to spend time with them and do things together.
When you think about the stress that we're under, I mean, obviously that's going to continue. The pace of life and communication and technology is going to increase, so we're going to have more stress in our lives. But wouldn't it be great if food was the opportunity to be the counterbalance,
sure,
to that stress? That if we really started to think about food as the opportunity to sit down and take a breath and to separate ourselves, to sort of detach ourselves from all the stresses around us, then we not only get those calories, but we really start to get a healthier body, increase our personal health, but also increase our emotional health as well.
My parents were always talking about when they were growing up, they'd have the big family dinners, and you know, they'd first turn off the TV, which is hard for me to understand, and they'd talk about feelings and what happened in their day, but things that were important to them. What are we missing by not having that?
You're missing everything. I am such a firm believer in the family dinner. Even if mom, dad, and the kids sit at the table and argue and bitch and moan at each other, at least you're communicating. When else are you going to have 25 or 30 minutes to sit down in a captive environment with,
right,
your kids and your parents? It doesn't happen. It's just a wonderful opportunity to have that time to talk. and you get a feel for where your kids are coming from, you get a feel from where your parents are coming from, and you're able to really, you know, talk about the day and look at the big picture.
And if we continue on this path, like say like in 5 years, if we're on the path even our parents have set for us, are we going to be crazy nuts like they are?
You're going to be absolutely nuts.
If we continue to, as teenagers, to live under these expectations, and live this lifestyle, what can we expect? What are the consequences as we get into our 20s, as we get into our 30s?
I think the consequences are unhappiness. It's not happy. You know, I think this is the age of stress and the age of anxiety, depression. You know, they say many, many people experience anxiety and depression that they never really acknowledge in themselves or are treated for. But I mean, I think that's the consequence is just a general unhappiness about your life. You know, what is my life all about?
Come on, Jack. Hi, Mom.
Hey, guys. Hey, Jack.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, sweetie. How's practice?
It's good.
Good? Is the coach there?
Yep.
Everybody there? How was Rick? Good. Hey, Danny.
Hi, Mom.
How's school?
It was alright.
Alright. What did you have for lunch today?
Let's see. Pizza and Mountain Dew.
Great. Hey, well, good news for you. I've got made reservations at that healthy vegan place we were talking about Friday night.
Serious.
Well,
it's gonna be fun.
Yeah, it will be. Guaranteed.
I remember like a long time ago, it was like the Glutton Bowl. Like they had like the World Series of like eating. Uh-huh. And there's all these like huge fat like white guys. Skinny Asian guy gets out there and just pounds them away.
He like dips it in water and
stuff.
Yeah. You seen that?
Ugh. Oh man. I got him.
Challenge him.
Oh, dude, my mom wants me to go to like a vegan rep.
I don't know.
Vegan. A vegan restaurant like this week.
Is that like no meat? And, oh, you can't from any animals or anything.
Really?
Yeah, so do.
Oh, no.
Ew.
I'm so not looking forward to that.
Marty, hey, pull my hoof.
Well, what's happened is this whole process, what we used to call agriculture, has changed to agribusiness. And the whole concept of animal husbandry has been replaced with more of almost a manufacturing attitude. But the whole idea is to get that animal from birth into the box as quickly as possible.
Is that why we have all these hormones and weird stuff being injected into them? What's going on with that?
Absolutely. I mean, if you take a look at the process today, there are some of the drug companies that are pushing the ranchers that, you know, shortly after that animal is born, you give it its first implant. They put it in the air. You give it its first implant of a growth hormone. When the animal is weaned, you put it into a feedlot immediately. And then they start feeding it this diet of corn, a real, what we call a hot ration, because it's got so much protein and it's made to put on that muscle as, you know, as quick as possible. But when those animals are crowded in so tightly and they're eating a diet that they're not meant to eat, they're going to get sick. So what do? You give them low levels of antibiotics with every meal, what we call subtherapeutic. And so they have this constant exposure to antibiotics just to make them grow as quickly as possible.
If they're putting antibiotics, if they're putting hormones in these sick cows to make them better, what is that going to do to me?
We see a reduction in the age of puberty, for example, in teens today. I mean, this is something that has been a really dramatic effect. It has shifted over the last 30 years, and part of that may be because of the hormones. We see breast cancer now in teenage girls. due to the hormones that are found in meat and milk products. I mean, we have antibiotics that are actually breeding superbugs and putting the safety of our families and our communities at risk. And they use these chemicals, Bobby, because it makes them money. Not because it's good for you or because it's a wise thing to do in terms of the future sustainability of our food supply. They do it because it makes them money.
Let me tell you, Kirby, I'm a little disappointed in this place. It looks much better in the brochure. Have you seen the movie An Inconvenient Truth? Hey, now that was inconvenient.
A quarter pound cheeseburger at a local fast food joint, 99 cents. Corn and water to feed the cattle, $30 billion. Land and topsoil wasted to raise the cattle, $75 billion. Non-renewable energy to transport cattle, $125 billion. Greenhouse gas emissions and other pollutions from cattle, $2 trillion. The lasting impact on our environment due to artificially priced factory farm foods, priceless. There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, we'll let the next generation pay.
Then you take them into the slaughter plants. Today, the modern slaughter plant can process 4,000 or 5,000 or even more head of animals every day.
They can use a cow for food as long as they can basically drag it off the truck.
So you have about 300 animals an hour that are going along this assembly line. Then the product, you know, goes as it goes into the grocery store, they may decide they want a little more profit out of it, so they'll inject it with 10% water solution that may have sodium phosphate in it. And then to top it off, they put it in a packaging that has small doses of carbon monoxide in it just to keep that meat looking as red as possible. So you think about, you know, what, you know, as we're eating that hamburger, we got the animal, it's got the growth hormones, it's got the antibodies, it's got that diet of corn that it wasn't meant to eat. It was injected with sodium phosphate when it was put in the package and then packaged up with a little carbon monoxide. Mmm, yum.
I'm hungry too, Dave. Let's grab a burger.
Nearly 100,000 cows are processed, a tidy little word for slaughtered, each and every day. That's enough beef to fill a huge football stadium. Think about that the next time you see a McDonald's sign that brags, billions and billions served.
And at the end of the day, you don't have any clue of where that meat came from. It's coming from all these different animals. So if there's a problem with one animal, there's E. coli, or if there's something like that, it's getting mixed around and it's getting shipped out to 30, 35, 40 different states. And that's why we have these problems that we have with, you know, E. coli comes up and all of a sudden people in 23 different states are getting sick because we have such a concentrated food system that it's all coming out of these centralized plants.
So I can be eating 1,055 different cows in my hamburger?
That's right. The muscle or fat tissue from over 1,000 animals can be in 1 4-ounce patty of beef.
In just one patty?
In one patty.
I feel like I should wear a condom next time I eat my Big Mac.
Well, that's not a bad analogy, because it is, you know, when we think about the danger, the food safety danger, because of, you know, if one sick animal gets processed and that meat gets mixed around, that muscle or fat gets mixed around, it can really cause a problem with the whole food system.
What the hell are they putting into a hot dog? What is in that? Are they free to do whatever they want and put whatever kind of meat?
You don't want to know what's in a hot dog, man. Let me introduce you to a concept called AMR. It stands for Advanced Meat Recovery. And what they do is they take a cow carcass after they've cut off all the good cuts of meat, and they essentially jam it through this machine. It's like a giant squeegee. And they squeeze out every bit of protein that they can get. And now I know this is gross, but this is exactly how it works. They get out the sinew, they get out the blood vessels, I mean, every piece of meat and juice they can squeeze out of this machine, that becomes beef, suitable for human consumption. That goes into hot dogs.
Gail, could you please take me on what the typical factory farm, meat producing factory is like, where the meat is going to, say, fast food places?
Well, production line speeds are so fast in these places and the workers are struggling so hard to keep up with the pace. At the individuals that I interviewed for my book, Slaughterhouse, admitted to me that they deliberately strangled, beat, scalded, skinned, and dismembered hundreds of thousands of fully conscious pigs and cows.
Why would they do that?
Well, because line speeds are so fast. One single slaughterhouse that I visited kills roughly 150,000 pigs a week.
What was probably the worst thing, in your opinion, that you saw?
The worst thing that I encountered was the complete removal of all the hide and the legs of fully conscious cattle, the only hide left on their bodies being that on their heads. And then there was the immersion of hundreds of thousands of conscious pigs into tanks of scalding water for de-hairing.
Are we supposed to be doing that? Is that regulation?
No, they're definitely not supposed to be doing that. They're supposed to be unconscious before they're ever scalded. They're supposed to be unconscious and dead. They're supposed to have be completely bled out. We documented the fact that workers would remove the hide and the legs while the cows were still conscious. In fact, I've got a great quote from a worker. He said, "Sometimes they go pretty far. Sometimes they're all peeled. Sometimes you can tell that they're alive because you can look in their eyes and you can see the tears of a cow. And their eyes are moving and everything. But mainly they just make a lot of noise and are trying to kick. This is when they have had all the skin removed from their body and their legs removed and they're still conscious."
How are they supposed to be killed at this point?
They're supposed to be rendered unconscious with a knocking gun, which delivers a blow to the head, renders them unconscious and actually kills them. But line speeds are so fast that workers can't, the person that operates the stunning device can't do a good job, and the animal's hung up and goes down the line for processing anyway.
Aren't there people whose job it is to make sure that this isn't happening, that there is some kind of integrity involved in this process?
No, there's no oversight on farms, and in slaughterhouses, the oversight is by the USDA.
It doesn't sound to me like it's really working.
No, it's not working at all.
When anything's killed, it has fear, and that adrenaline goes into the tissues. And that fear of death goes into the tissues.
Is it a spiritual thing or like a chemical thing with the brain like you were talking about?
It's both.
Do these animals feel pain?
Oh, sure. They're just paralyzed. They can feel pain.
What can we do besides putting handcuffs on certain government officials to put an end to this cruelty?
The bottom line, I think, is that each and every one of you can speak out for the animals. These poor animals can't speak for themselves. They don't have a voice, and it's up to your generation to be their voice, and every voice counts.
When consumers learn about these issues, they're choosing to go vegetarian or vegan is on the rise, you know, no animal products at all, or they're just simply choosing to consume products that are not raised so cruelly. Mm-hmm. And of course, there are many happy endings here at Animal Acres. When these animals do survive these cruel conditions and they can come here and have, you know, hope and love and joy for the first time in their lives, and then they in turn teach other people to look at them as animals, with the hope that maybe if people see that a turkey is a lot more like a dog, that maybe they won't eat them.
I don't even know what to do. That's why I skate. I snowboard and I surf just to get all that stress out of my mind. Because when I skate, I don't think of anything else. When I snowboard, I don't think of anything else. It sets my mind to a different part, and it just makes me concentrate on like life and makes me think of all the positive things, not the negative things. So it's kind of my stress relief.
I don't want to grow up. Don't want to figure this out. I know you set me up. Don't want this dragging you down. I don't wanna grow up. Don't wanna figure this out. I know you set me up. Don't want this dragging you down. I don't wanna grow up. Don't wanna figure this out. I know you set me up. Don't want this dragging you down. Don't want this dragging you down. Don't wanna see you around. Don't wanna see you around.
Hey, Blake. My mom said it was okay for me to get the newest Mega Monster energy drink. You gotta see this thing. It's supposed to be real good.
Cool. How much was it?
Who cares? My mom gave me the money. Wahoo!
It seems that every few years we go through a new trend, a fad in the kinds of beverages we drink. Today, it's energy drinks. These things didn't exist just a few years ago when we were standing in line waiting to give Starbucks $4 for a coffee drink. Soft drink companies will stop at nothing to convince you that drinking their soda will make you popular. And if you don't, you're a loser.
As a general rule, I use this rule all the time. If you never drink another soda again in your life, it's fine.
You see it in every population around the world, Bobby, that starts to drink soda. They begin to suffer the same diseases that we suffer from here in the United States. Depression, psychosis, obesity, diabetes, and osteoporosis. I mean, 30 years ago, you would have thought it was crazy to see teenagers with osteoporosis. Today, it's common.
I've heard a lot about aspartame. Can you tell me what aspartame is?
Well, aspartame is a chemical substance that is the creation of two existing natural products that, when put together, create aspartame that has a very powerful sweet taste. But it's not absorbed in your body, so it has no calories. So that's why it's so widely used in foods, but it's a chemical.
Is it safe for us to be using this?
There has been rumors that it's not that safe. When I look at young kids, I always say stay away from something that is not natural, because you have a long life to live ahead of you, and the less chemicals you put inside your body, the better off you are.
Fire one! Fire two!
Bummer.
Fire three!
Oh, yeah. Which one was that?
Now, let's see. That was aspartame?
So, what did you guys here at Cyril do with aspartame?
Well, Mr. Rumsfeld, the war ended and we never got a chance to deploy it.
It says here it tastes sweet, like sugar. Ladies and gentlemen, we have found the weapons of mass destruction that we have been looking for.
And the thing of it is that aspartame is criminal, because it actually was listed with the Pentagon in an inventory of prospective biochemical warfare weapons. The FDA actually not only revoked the petition for approval,
right,
but they tried to indict the company, and they knew they were in hot trouble, so both U.S. prosecutors were hired by the defense team. And what happened was that Don Rumsfeld, the CEO of Cyril, and he says, I don't care, I'll call in my markers and get it approved anyway.
Many doctors have serious health concerns about aspartame, and I'm a person who also has serious health concerns. Aspartame is classified as an excitotoxin, which means it is toxic to the nervous system. So that means your brain, your eyes, your spine. And aspartame is known to cause dizziness, seizures, migraine, headaches. I mean, it is a chemical that does not belong in the food supply, and if we had an honest system of regulation, it would have been banned long ago.
Okay, listen up, men. There are over 50 million teens out there. Now, what can we make and get them to buy?
We could increase the caffeine in the coffee we sold them.
Well, the energy drinks we came up with are doing well. Maybe we could create a line of energy pizzas. We'll throw on more spices and call them herbal supplements.
Nah, too costly. What more can we do with tap water and high fructose corn syrup?
Fructose or high fructose corn syrup is just a cheap way to make a liquid sweetener that's gotten into all kinds of products because it's less expensive. and it really worries me.
And that's been very much related to the epidemic of diabetes. The fructose corn syrup is a complete disaster. Now, it also puts on weight because you don't actually feel full from it. So you don't have the mechanism to shut off. So the high fructose corn syrup really gets into weight gain in a big way.
So you buy these sugar-free, low-sodium products thinking that you're going to get something healthy when in fact you might be killing yourself faster.
Well, diet products are not healthy. Let's get that straight. And by the way, they do not promote weight loss. I mean, diet products do not help you lose body fat. Not at all.
Just for the money?
It's all about the cash, of course. Think they care about you, or they care about money?
I'd like to think they care about me.
You're wrong.
The federal government, the USDA, your state board of education, the school district, your principal, and I agree that this lunch meets or exceeds the nutritional standards established for a healthy meal. How dare you question us? Next.
They've put 12 men on the moon. But for some reason, our government can't figure out how to service a healthy, nutritious meal when we're at school. How hard is it to make a turkey sandwich?
Let's actually have a generation of healthy children instead of feeding them all this junk food and these hydrogenated oils and these artificial chemicals in their foods. And for a school to serve these things to children that they're trying to teach is so outlandish that I can't believe it's happening in this country.
From the website here, CUSD Food Service continues to be a leader in offering healthier foods and options to students. Mm-hmm. And well, I have the menu. Looks like Friday, February 2nd, we have cheese pizza, there's chicken fingers, mini corn dogs. The pizza has a V. What does this V entail?
I don't know.
This says vegetarian. The cheese pizza, as a vegetarian, is this it?
I don't know. I guess if you got it from the school, I don't.
It was gonna go in a student's belly. This is the V vegetarian. Mm-hmm. Is this the best option we have?
So what you have there is cheese, tomato sauce, and bread.
Well, I'm not sure because it says cheese pizza substitute pizza.
Yeah, might not be completely 100% cheese.
What's the substitution part?
I don't know. Those are the kinds of questions I really wouldn't have answers for you on.
It doesn't seem to me like these are the best options that we can offer if we're continuing to push the envelope for healthier eating in our schools, especially elementary schools. Mm-hmm.
In just a few moments, we're going to create some action. I'm going to sign legislation that will ban all junk food and all sodas from our public schools.
Every so often, you'll see some politician making claims about all the healthy things they're going to do for your school. They're usually standing next to an idiot from the beverage or snack industry. And what gets done? Not a whole lot.
Let me tell you, when I sign this legislation, this will be the toughest school nutrition reform in the nation.
Would you mind just explaining to me not only how this is a healthy option for vegetarian kids or kids in general?
Right. So what happens is there's USDA standards of what defines a school lunch. No one ever talked about how good it has to take. It just has to follow mechanical rules. It has to have so much protein, so much carbohydrate, and so many calories per serving. And guess what? This gets an A+.
This isn't a good option to have.
Exactly. But that's what I'm saying. It's all done on mechanics. Does it meet the criteria? Absolutely. And this school system doesn't want to be closed down. It doesn't want to get cited for having not followed the rules. But no one from the checking bureau from the USDA ever comes in and say, well, let me taste this thing. I wonder what the school's children think. So we have a disconnect here. We have food that follows sort of rigid rules, like, you know, of accounting. Like, you gotta have these number of calories and protein in it. You gotta have so much vegetable. The kid gets it. It tastes terrible. The kid throws it in the trash. So now the kid's got zero nutrition. And we've got food that tastes bad. The system is so screwed up, it just doesn't make any sense. Would I want to eat it? Would I want my children to eat it? No way.
How did Coke and Pepsi and vending machines serving junk food get into our schools in the first place?
Well, basically, there weren't a lot of options 20 years ago when they got in, and people really didn't understand the harmful effects of high fructose content, aspartame, and these other products. And so they got entree in there, and they gave money to the schools. And the schools got used to taking this money, and God knows what they do with this money, but they take this money every year. They allow these machines to be in there because these big soft drink companies have figured out if they get the kids hooked at an early age, it'll continue throughout their life.
It's a huge issue nationwide now because the legislature, the laws that are made that mandate certain things in schools are made by those people that you elect. And if they know that you care about that as an issue, they're going to make it more of an issue.
Are they going to take it seriously? Are they going to be like, you know, just eat your chicken pot pie and get out of here? Are they actually going to listen to us?
If they want to get elected, they're going to listen to us.
Yeah, because some of it's crap. I mean, these kids are eating. It's disgusting.
It's absolutely disgusting. And the only way to fix that is to start that dialogue. And so I started from the top with legislators, with mm-hmm. lawmakers and your congressmen and things like that, all the way to the bottom, which is the PTAs and the people working in your cafeteria and your student body. And somewhere in the middle, we're gonna meet and make it better.
Hi, here's your menu.
Thanks.
Can I get you both something to drink to start out with, besides water?
Just water, fine.
Okay, how about you?
Water and a hot chocolate.
With cream? Yeah, sounds good.
I'll eat all the stuff it comes with. Look, it comes with soup and salad and steamed vegetables. And my choice of french fries, steamed rice, or mashed potatoes. So I'll get the mashed potatoes.
That's fine because I'm not going to eat any of that.
Okay.
Don't you want some like meat or something?
No. No, I'm just getting whatever, all the stuff that this comes with.
Okay, sounds good. And what about you?
Okay, yeah.
You're gonna share it? I'll bring an extra plate then.
Okay.
Sounds good. Here, I'll go ahead and take your menus.
Thank you.
Thank you. Did you want me to box that up for you?
Oh no, I'll probably eat it.
Yeah, okay, sounds good.
Yeah, I'm terrible shot.
Take this for me.
Just
make it get out of my face. The soup looks kind of good, but kind of weird.
You eat so much. It's the only meal that you eat a lot of is sushi. You eat that all day. It's deceptive because you'll eat, it's small, so you'll have it, but then like after it's all said and done, you have like 10 rolls. And that's like a lot of food because that rice expands. It's huge. You're eating more than you think.
Stop it.
But it's cool because you don't care. You're like, I like it. It's fine. You can eat all you want.
I ain't going on a diet.
That's ridiculous. You should be like Nicole Richie and gain weight.
I feel like I'm just doing nothing and everyone notices and everyone is disappointed or something and everyone... I feel like no one even expects anything of me anymore because I let him down.
How does someone come to that point to become bulimic or anorexic?
Bulimia is that response to, I can't keep up the anorexic pace. I've got to do something where I can still eat.
So Kira, you're 17, you're 18 years old. What went wrong?
I just started taking things to the next level, and I ended up purging my food one night, and I just thought, you know, hey, this is a great way to lose weight. My whole mind was just focusing on weight and food and just trying to become perfect at it, to be perfect at something.
We're a society of short-term rewards. We really look for that immediate reinforcement.
Right.
And food certainly is one of those things. And we can self-reinforce by feeding ourselves as a reward.
I just always felt like I could lose more pounds, and I felt very confident at a really low weight when I'd go out, mm-hmm. But every time I went out, I'd see someone thinner than me, so I just felt never good enough, and I really did not like the way I looked. It's a lot of low self-esteem.
Well, the key factor in bulimia and anorexia is really what we call a distorted body image, okay? Mm-hmm. Assuming neither of us have an eating disorder, we can look in a mirror and go, well, you know, I look a little chubby, or
right.
God, I'm doing okay, all mm-hmm. right? A person who has bulimia or anorexia can look, to me or you, scary skinny. I mean, you know, like concentration camp skinny.
Right.
And they look in the mirror and they see a big fat pig. It's a distortion of their ability to see what they really
and
look like.
A distortion of their mental image of what like perfection is, or
it's
or
not
ideal, what a woman should look like?
It's not so much perfection or what an ideal woman should look like, it's really what they look like. It's just a distortion of what they look like. And yes, they do look in magazines and compare themselves and things like that, but it's an over-exaggerated distortion of their ability to see their own image.
Big part of the disorder is how big of a secret it is, and it's just very shameful. People who have this disorder are very ashamed of themselves and do not want anyone to know. They just want everyone to know that they're perfect, and you know, people will be asking, you know, how do you do it? How do you stay so fit? And how do you, you know, have such discipline with what you eat? It's a complete secret.
They know it's bad.
Right.
They don't want to have their teeth rotting. They don't want to have ripped up hands. They don't want to smell like puke.
Do you think you were consumed as much mentally as you were physically?
Yeah, definitely. When I'd be talking to you like this, I wouldn't really, or I wouldn't even really be talking. You'd be talking to me, and I would just be like going, feedback, and you'd be thinking that I'm paying attention, but really all I'd be thinking about is food and weight. And it's just a way to avoid, you know, my real problems in life.
The eating disorder is not the fundamental problem. The fundamental problem is what caused the eating disorder. And that could be family strife, it could be anxiety, it could be depression, it could be any number of things.
What's that doing to your body then when you're not eating? You're throwing up.
It's killing
you. That's gotta be killing you.
It's killing you in many different ways. It's killing you, you know, again, electrolyte-wise, it's killing your heart, your muscles, your brain. We need energy to grow, we need energy to function. And if you're not getting that energy in, you're gonna crash and burn. A parent or a friend is gonna look at somebody and say, you know what, Bobby, you've got an eating disorder. Damn it, quit making yourself puke.
Mm-hmm.
Just here, eat something, okay? That's not the approach, all right? The not puking and the eating is not the way you approach it. You gotta get behind it, and you gotta figure out why are you not eating and why are you making yourself puke. It becomes a cycle. The binging and purging becomes a cycle. The not eating becomes a cycle because they get thin and they look and they think they're fat and they get thinner. And they look and they think they're fat and they get thinner. And it just keeps going.
When you think about eating a taco, this is not what you have in mind.
Okay, well then don't think about eating a taco.
I'll try.
Something's
going on
over here.
It's alright.
It's alright.
It was worth a try.
Okay. Well, that's good.
I think it's really great you guys tried something new.
Yeah.
It was a big step for them. It was maybe too big of a leap from where they were.
Yeah.
But it was good.
I don't know, I prefer my real meat. But it was okay.
Why is it that when I eat one of these chips that are just so tasty, why can I not put them down? Is there a guy working at this particular plant whose job it is to make me addicted to these things?
Yes.
So there is that one guy sitting there.
Not only is there a guy, there's probably a whole department that's their job is to make sure that you eat that whole can.
It's safe to say that most of us have no idea what we're eating. We don't know the ingredients, have little knowledge of how or when it was made, and no understanding of its nutritional value. They want us to have no clue what additives, preservatives, and chemicals have been put in the food we eat to improve its flavor or retain freshness.
And I think you hit the nail on the head. Anything that can last in a box, usually the shelf life's 2 years. Would you want that in your body lasting in there 2 years?
I don't want meat product going inside me that's been on the shelf for 2 years and still cold.
Right, right.
Americans want quick, cheap, convenient food. And if you look at the ingredients list on something like this, it's actually kind of scary. It starts off with high fructose corn syrup. And then the bologna is made from mechanically separated chicken and pork and corn syrup.
My bologna has a first name.
It's O-S-E-A-R.
Modified food starch.
So chicken, pork, and syrup. My bologna has a second name.
It's M-A-Y-E-R.
Yeah, there you go. Mm. And you just go down the list. It's a lot of chemicals and artificial foods.
Why do we need this? Why?
We don't need that. And we deserve food that is convenient, healthy, and delicious. And people are starting to make some of that. It's starting to be available. If you look for that, demand that, choose that, we can change the way that people are fed.
Dude, Dr. Green, you're not kidding. This is like an essay.
Is equal to the square root of the remaining side, thus proving MC square. So how about we add a little bit of this one with that one and
What we did for your generation was fed you processed white flour and jarred baby foods that were heavily processed and didn't taste like the real stuff. And so then when you ate a fresh peach when you were 15 months old, you didn't like it, even though you'd had jarred peaches before. So your taste buds have been trained the wrong way.
What's even crazier is that the information on the nutrition label on all packaged foods is based on the honor system. The government trusts these manufacturers to be honest in their labeling. There's more bureaucracy involved in the state issuing you a driver's license than in a food company putting out a new product.
They're advertising to children. They're pushing products that they know cause obesity, diabetes, depression, heart disease, cancer, osteoporosis. They know these foods cause these disorders, but you know what? They are not financially responsible for the health effects on the consumer, so it's not their business.
So let me get this straight. I can accept the fact that big food companies are in it for the money, that's fine. But if there's essentially no one monitoring how they make the food, what goes into it, and how they label it, and we all know that it's bad for us, then I can assume that these companies are intentionally producing and selling items that they know are gonna harm us. Just for the money.
Yeah. Welcome to the real world, man.
2 all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese,
pickles, onions.
On a sesame seed bun. You guys know this.
Well, that one.
You've got it down.
Been brainwashed through our lives.
That is so true.
What's the slogan for lettuce?
What's the slogan for tomatoes?
Tomatoes.
Why are they left out of the group? Yeah, what's the slogan for Whole Foods?
Yeah.
Whole Foods.
We're good for you. Yeah, kind of doesn't work as much.
It's not working.
All right, we get it. The eating habits of most teens are crap. But what other options are there?
I mean, you can get organic foods in any grocery store now. Walmart carries organic food. It's like, this is too easy.
No pesticides on it, and the soil's actually been cleaned for 3 years before you could even start growing on it. So it's been cleaned out of whoever else has been there before.
Is that the law of organic?
That's the law of organic.
Gosh, I can make a conscious decision right now whether I'm going to go in and buy this fast food hamburger, or whether, you know, I might go buy something that comes from a grass-fed animal, or from bison, or from an organic, or, you know, whatever.
So we have depleted food, we have, you know, synthetic food, and we have genetically engineered food, and none of that really is so good for us. Okay, we got to keep that in mind. It's not some breakthrough, it's actually, you get dumbed down. And when you go on to organic, your brain really begins to work better, period.
People are being separated from the foods that they really need to be healthy and intelligent and have good mental awareness and good longevity. And it's a giant hoax. I mean, the food industry today is a hoax. The things that you see marketed are the very things that are going to harm you the most. And the things that will help you, the things that will keep you healthy, are almost never publicized.
Here are two nice looking apples. One has been sprayed with at least 9 pesticides and laden with herbicide and fungicide. It's probably had its DNA rearranged a few times, painted red, then shellacked with a coat of wax. The other is an apple that God gave us. This one came from a simple apple tree, without all the industrialized crap that the other one has. What's totally nuts is that this undoctored apple needs to have this label that says organic on it to make it look appealing, and the Franken apple doesn't have any warning label to let us know how deadly it is.
I'm vegetarian, so no meat, no flesh at all.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How'd your mom deal with it when you said, hey, look, I'm a vegetarian?
My mom was like, right when I told her, she was like, no, I'm not supporting this.
I have no son.
Yeah, you're a meat eater and all this stuff. And like, you know, you belong eating meat and everything. And she's like, I'm not giving into this. And within like 2 weeks, she's buying me like vegetarian lasagnas, mm-hmm. and like buying me vegetarian guides. And so, I don't know, she just took a little softening, and then she's actually been really, really supportive.
Cool. What is a vegan? Can you explain to me?
Well, they don't eat any animal products, so no dairy, no meat, anything like that.
So nothing from animals?
No, no animal products at all.
For me, I was always told growing up, you know, drink milk every day. Isn't milk healthy? Shouldn't you be drinking milk?
Milk is healthy for a cow with 4 stomachs. The Homo sapien with 1 stomach is not designed to eat another animal's milk.
It would actually be smarter for humans to drink human breast milk, but even that would be weird. Especially,
well, yeah. I don't know, right? I'm going to explain to mom I need to suck a little bit to get some milk.
No, it's an odd thing, but why do you see adult human beings drinking infant formula from another species?
I love that, because I've never thought about it that way. And it totally changes your perspective on what you think of milk.
It's infant formula, and it's not even infant formula
for cow.
Humans. Yeah, for a cow.
What is it to eat raw food?
Raw food consists of eating fruits, nuts, vegetables, seeds, and grains. And you don't cook them, you eat them raw.
Why is that good for you?
In a nutshell, eating raw food is good for you because you don't kill the enzymes in the food. And enzymes, very simplified, is like energy. So when you kill the energy, you no longer get it from your food, and it depletes your own body's energy, therefore creating problems in your body.
And how long have you been doing this?
I've been eating raw food for 13 years.
Was it your choice, or was it something your family did?
It was definitely not my choice to go raw.
Yeah?
I got sick with diabetes, and my mom refused to go to medicine because medicine didn't offer us any hope. She read all the medical books she could get her hands on and started researching alternatives, found raw food, and completely changed our surroundings.
Really? Are you still diabetic?
I'm no longer diabetic.
Really?
No.
Do you attribute that to the raw food?
100%.
How do you guys get your protein? Don't you have to eat meat to get protein? Are you lacking that in your diet?
You gotta love that question. Out of all the questions I get asked, that one I get asked the most.
Me too.
Yeah,
me too.
And in this day and age, it's really silly with all the information that's out there that people are still asking that question. A couple things that have more protein than meat: green leafy vegetables.
Really?
Certain nuts and seeds, hemp seeds, and sprouted beans and grains.
Is it weird because, you know, you have a different lifestyle?
You know, it's weird if you make it weird. I know that the older I've gotten, I'm 22 now, the more people my age respect differences. I hope to always keep my mind open no matter what I'm doing, because I'm not in it for the dogma. I'm not in it to say I'm gonna be 100% raw food for the rest of my life, no matter if I get sick or whatever. I'm in it for health and for feeling good. That's the reason I started. We're the next generation, and you gotta start eating healthier. Where this world goes is in our hands, because something crazy is gonna happen in our lifetime. I feel it. And let's make it good crazy.
Absolutely. Well said.
Hey.
Hi.
Aren't you glad I made you wear a jacket?
Yes.
Okay, we gotta go.
I'm kind of like anxious about my mom and like why I act differently around her than with other, like, my friends. So I have to be, like, a good girl around her, and then, like, I have a lot more energy around my friends than with my mom. I'm comfortable around guys, but I don't know how to, like, get their attention, you know? I have no self-control over, like, how much I eat and what I eat and stuff like that. I just want to be cool, I guess. I want to be really accepted.
And no more words tonight. I will just breathe the air. I'd like some peace tonight.
And she's like, I don't think she means to, but she does embarrass me. But no, she won't listen because she's afraid she's turning into her mom, and it's just like a whole nother issue.
Here, like you're 4 years old. Get off the computer.
Okay, it's off.
Thank you.
It's the dawn of a new day. We've been taken advantage of, manipulated, and lied to. And we're not gonna take it anymore.
We have the opportunity to
put the problems of the past behind us and create a better
future for us all.
We've cleaned house, and it's time for us to move in. It is the dawn of a new day.
See, we got an energy drink fan, obviously, here.
Yeah.
Yeah?
A lot of them.
A lot of them?
Yeah, drink a lot. I've already had two, so kind of wound up right now.
Yeah, I was going to say, calm down. Take a breath.
I have never worn a dress.
That's not fair.
That's just an obvious thing. I'm wearing a dress right now.
Recently?
No. What about a dress
or ever
dress?
In your life? Like
ever in your life.
Ever in your
Put
life.
Put it in. Ever in your life.
Learn something new every day.
I love it.
All of you guys?
Sometimes I'll get the big rock stars, the 24-ounce ones.
And those things, man, they're big. I mean,
I think
that's got to give you some sugar.
Yeah, I think there's 82 grams of sugar.
Really?
Yeah. So
a nice healthy daily dose there.
Yeah, yeah.
Get you through the day.
Besides all the other stuff, too.
I have never lied to my mother to get out of trouble.
Crazy.
You've never done that?
Yeah, you have. Don't lie.
Not to my mom. To my dad plenty of times.
Find trouble.
Just find everything with you.
Right
okay, I guess I'm gonna be the first one out.
Yeah, that's your
Aww.
It's a gang up on me.
Oh. I'm next.
Yeah.
I
are we all just like volunteering our pennies right now?
No, oh. I forgot about that 8 times. Okay.
Do you feel like you're overwhelmed sometimes with all the stuff you're doing?
Yes.
Really?
Definitely.
All the rehearsals and plays. Well, you said yourself you missed a couple dances, right?
I missed all the dances this year because of shows.
Did your boyfriend get to go? You have a boyfriend, right?
Mm-mm. Never have one.
I've never made out with anyone before. All of you, no.
Ah!
I got finals tomorrow, and it's not looking forward to it.
Have you done the ACT or the SAT yet?
SAT.
How'd that go?
Well, not as good as I'd hoped.
Really?
But, you know, I did all right.
Well, that's good. Did you just take it once?
No, I took it a couple times.
Yeah.
Gee. Come on, it was Halloween.
I'm
5'1". Shopping.
And shopping? Well, you go to school right next to a mall, so it's
yeah,
like,
it's hard not
obviously,
to.
Yeah.
It's hard not
get
to
out and
just
go right to
do a pit stop there.
Yeah, exactly. Skip class and I'll find you in the mall.
Skip class, yeah, or I was almost late today going to the mall.
Really?
Oh yeah, I just have class right now.
Shopping problem.
Yeah, a little bit. It's more like looking at clothes and not buying them.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Just idea shopping.
Yeah. Idea shopping and like, maybe one day I'll get paid and get money and go shopping.
Yeah.
But never gonna happen.
I've never eaten pastrami.
I love pastrami.
I've never eaten it.
It's all in some.
What
yeah.
am I? I'm
yeah.
like failing. I don't like failing.
Pasadena.
I'm getting you back.
Come on.
Getting serious. Serious.
Boogers.
I see it in your face, boy.
Oh, yes.
You wanna know my name?
Consider the following, if you will. Four typical teenagers, assembled in this Southern California home. The purpose? To find out how well they can get along, as they prepare their favorite food.
Your food sucks.
Oh, is that sausage good?
It's alright.
Well, never mind, I'm not gonna take credit for that. I was gonna like,
are you
feel
chewing
like,
the
thanks,
ice?
You're welcome, but I just
I wanna
like,
try
you're,
that
like chewing bones.
Here, have a bite. Or actually, don't have a bite of mine, I'm sorry. Yeah, there's a ton more.
Alright, I'll go get some.
Yeah, because I made like a bunch, and this is almost too much. I'm full already.
You don't like the sausage?
Are there any more Capri Suns?
I don't like sausage. So you have seen it?
Of course I have. Who have you
it
seen Charlie and Candy Mountain?
No, I have not.
Go look it up, please.
Charlie.
A beautiful kitchen. Full pantry. Stocked refrigerator. And what did they choose? Spaghetti. Hot dogs. Steak. Mac and cheese. Looks like our teens found solace in the comfort zone.
Why is it that my generation is sicker than when you were a kid?
It's because of what's in the food. It's the sodas, Bobby. It's the phosphoric acid. It's the aspartame, the chemical sweeteners, the artificial colors. All of these artificial chemicals are put into the foods and then they're heavily marketed. They're positioned as being cool or sexy or even healthy when they're not.
What would you do?
With a Klondike bar.
or for a Klondike bar. What'd you do with your Klondike bar is your business, pal.
When today's high school students were born, finding high blood pressure in a high school student was really unusual. It was a disease of middle-aged guys. Finding abnormal cholesterol in a high school student was really unusual. It was a middle-aged condition. Finding abnormal blood sugar was a middle-aged condition, unusual. A waist size over 40 inches was unusual. But you know what? Today, 2/3 of America's high school students already have at least one of those conditions, middle-aged conditions.
What is causing that? What is going on?
A lot of things have changed. The toxins in our environment is one thing. The amount of sleep kids are getting is another. The amount of exercise kids are getting is another. But a huge one is the way that we eat.
When we consume those concentrated forms of toxic chemicals and heavy metals, then we tend to concentrate them in our own tissues. And that's how we end up with conditions like Alzheimer's disease or even diabetes.
There's an epidemic of type 2, what used to be adult onset in kids. Now, why a young guy should be concerned? The number one reason for a 20-year-old going blind is from diabetes. The number one reason for a 20-year-old to get erectile dysfunction is from diabetes. There's lots of reasons to be concerned.
They can reverse diabetes or prevent cancer simply by making different choices at restaurants or the grocery store. We've got to take control because no one out there is looking out for your interests or my interests or the interests of the public at large.
What the hell is the FDA for?
Oh, the FDA, come on. The FDA is out there to promote the interests of the companies that give it money. The FDA actually takes money from pharmaceutical companies and it promotes their interests.
Looks like the bosses are changing things again.
I wonder what we're calling things today.
The human body is designed to be the perfect machine. What you see on the outside isn't always a reflection of what's going on inside.
How many energy drinks have you had today? Honest.
I had a huge Rockstar, one of the Rockstar juice, the big ones.
Okay, you want to hear the bad news?
Is that
blood pressure is 150 over 90.
Okay.
Your blood pressure is about 115 over 78. Okay. Rockstar. Okay. Seriously.
Do you take any like diet pills or anything like that? Have you ever done that? No.
Okay. No. They're fun.
How about like laxatives or anything like that? You know, do you have any friends that have ever done that stuff?
I don't think so. Okay. Not that they tell me. That's okay. Kind of embarrassing.
That's cool. There's a lot of teenagers and young women who
colonics and stuff.
Well, they do that kind of stuff, and there's also the people who have issues with eating at all and with binging and purging and things like that. Have you had any problems with that or?
I never binged.
How about the purging?
Yeah, I have.
Consistently or?
Yeah, consistently at certain points.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tell me how do you feel? When you do that, I just
gross.
Okay, and that's important.
Yeah.
I mean, because there are some kids who do that and they don't feel gross.
No, it's not like I'm like ooh.
How do you feel about your body?
I hate my body.
Okay, why? In what way?
I'm fat.
Are your mom or dad overweight?
Yes.
Okay.
We all are.
Okay. All right. And what do you think that does to the whole picture, as far as you're concerned?
Doesn't really set a great example. Don't know really what to do exactly. My mom's always like, you can get the lead if you would lift some weight.
Hmm.
my dad, the one that's been raising me. He's a very successful businessman, and he's one of those people that wants to control my life, and he wants to have control over my life. That's why, like, he is my financial support, so he holds that against me. He wanted me to go to school and get a job. This has been for like 4 years now. And went to school, got a job, and I wasn't good for enough for him. And he was like, get another job. And like, he just keeps on adding stuff to it. I'm just like, what do you want me to do? I'm doing everything you're saying, and you just keep on adding stuff.
When you think about your relationship with your mom and when you relate to her, what kinds of feelings and emotions do you end up feeling about yourself? Do you?
I feel really stupid, like I'm not good enough, I feel like I can never do anything like perfectly right around her. Mm. I know she's pounding me about like some things, but like other things, I just can never do right.
Just think like, I don't know, I just don't see myself as like good enough.
Not good enough.
If I were to like meet myself when I was, I don't know, like 12, 13, like, I don't know, still like a pure-minded person, I'd be like, oh, what is wrong with you? What did you do to your life? You know what I mean? And I feel like if I'm not happy with the way that I am, like, how am I gonna be happy ever, you know? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's, I guess, what I'm trying, I don't know.
It's what you struggle with inside.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had this girlfriend for 2 years, and like, we're kind of on a break right now, but we're not. That's one of those weird thing, the girl issue thing. And her philosophy of it is, it's like we're together, but we're not. Whatever that means.
When you look at yourself as a person, when you think of yourself as a person, are there things that you struggle with inside in terms of how you feel about yourself? Are you aware of any thoughts or feelings that you feel about yourself that you struggle with, if you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Can you share a little bit about that?
I don't know. Kind of pessimistic, very... I don't know, I guess I might hide that with sarcasm a lot. When I'm talking with people, when most people who see me, that I just act normal, or whatever normal is. Mm-hmm. But, like, when I'm by myself in my room and just thinking, I trip out, I guess. Mm-hmm. Just thinking about life in general. Mm. Whatever path I go down, bottom line, just what's the point?
Yeah, I got it. If you had the power to let go of something, if you had the power to be free of something inside of you that would really make a difference, what would you like to be free of?
Lots of things.
Yeah, name a few. If you could be free of certain feelings.
Being so afraid that people don't like me.
Even though life kind of does seem pointless a lot of the time, it's like, I don't know what comes next, so... the only guarantee is right now, so you gotta just keep doing it.
Mm-hmm. I don't eat anything, and then I'll drink like a Jamba Juice and throw it up.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's disgusting.
Yeah, and that started when you were about 15?
13.
Oh, 13.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I don't even know how, I mean, it kind of started off as like, oh, I'm sick, look how much weight I just lost, let's see if, I don't, and then it just kind of just got progressively worse and worse to the point where I was like, like, multiple times a day.
Did you throw up?
Yeah, and I don't know, I just would like feel dizzy and stuff, like I couldn't do like normal things after a while, because I was like, so, I've had nothing in my body, and then whatever was in my body, I don't know. I might have like gotten rid of like a lung or something. I don't even know.
So it was really hurting you physically?
Yeah.
Was it impacting you physically?
Yeah.
Being afraid Not being afraid of what your mom thinks.
And what she does, like, I feel like I can never do anything right around her. And I... And whenever she does that, I just kind of like draw in myself and I don't yell back. And when I do, I get in more trouble. And she's like, oh, you can tell me anything. No, you can't. You can't talk to your parents about everything. They think you can. No, you can't. But like other things, like relationships and like acceptance, they'll just like butter you up and say, don't worry about being accepted, everyone. You should just be glad of who you are. No, doesn't work like that.
I feel like I like shut myself off for so long to like feeling things like, no, like letting myself feel pain that I don't know if I'm gonna be able to feel like, I don't know, I'm scared.
I just go grab something that like tastes good, like comfort food. I don't think like it's nutritional value or whatever. And I just end up eating it, and it tastes good. Makes me feel better for the time being. And I'm just like, oh, well, that didn't help me.
Yeah, I just want to be my own boss. I don't want to work for someone else. I can't work for someone else. I don't want to be the person to go sit behind a cubicle working 9 to 5 every day, going depressed to work every day, going, I want to kill myself. Why? What am I doing here? I'm not happy. I want to be happy. I want to do something that I like.
Yeah, I guess what I'm hearing is that kind of just kind of falling into the pattern of what everyone else does. What?
And I really don't want to. I don't want to do that. I really don't.
Yes. Yeah. It's like you would.
I'd prefer to do something different, but what else is there?
Yeah.
Otherwise, you'd feel lonely in your life.
Is it normal for, especially teenagers, to have these kind of feelings and emotions bottled up?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think that's part of the struggle is that these budding feelings and questions emerge, and there's often the conflict of how can I fit in with other people, with my group? How can I be myself in my group? Can I ever talk about these things with my parents?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the end result is that they just bottle it up. It's like it, and it turns into, I think, a real source of poor self-esteem in a way, that because the person feels like there's something wrong with them, which in fact, they're not. There's nothing wrong.
So it's normal to be feeling all these crazy feelings.
Yeah.
Doctors, we picked these four kids, not because their issues are really unique, but because they're so normal. They're just like millions of other American kids. Dr. Weiss, can you tell me what's going on with Danny?
Danny is very typical of a lot of teens today. He's a healthy, athletic, outgoing, really, you know, great kid who eats way, way, way too much junk food. And... that's not anything that he didn't already know, but Danny has the same issues that a lot of other kids do with time management and finding the place to prioritize his own health, and he has not yet learned that lesson.
You ask yourself a lot is, what's the point of it all? What's the point of my life? And the fact that another thing that I recall is that you don't like being told what to do. And I think that, that tells me that you have a potential for high self-initiative, something that you can generate yourself, that you want to accomplish in your life.
I remember when we did your physical and the reality check of how your eyes opened up when your blood pressure was elevated because you hadn't been eating right and all that. And I hope that was an eye-opener for you and a light bulb went on for you, because you have to prioritize your health and your nutrition and your fitness, because you're not going to be there for your family down the road if you don't. And right now you're a healthy guy. Your blood work is all good. Everything's all good. But these are things that are silent, and these are things that are cumulative over time. And right now you need to have that maturity and take that next step to say, all right, I feel great. Everything's good. But it may not be in 15 years or 20 years.
My suggestion to you would be to follow your heart. Get into something that you really enjoy doing. I know that you mentioned you were interested in film and moving in that direction. And I think the things that, that you're drawn to in your life are the things that are important, that, that are offering you some kind of answers.
I can follow my heart. I know I can eat better. Yeah, I remember getting that blood pressure up, because I've been told once before it was kind of a little high. I don't want to be like 10 years down the line, be like overweight and unhealthy and not be able to do the things that I want to do. So
you're at the point in your life where many teens and young adolescents are, and that's that you think you're the man. And a lot of the things that you do in your life are silent, that, that may be causing problems, and you don't realize they are. And it's a real big sign of maturity for you to be able to get to that next step and say, okay, I realize that some of these things I'm doing are not real good for me, i.e. energy drinks, yeah. Okay? You drink those, you don't feel any different really, but over time, your heart and your blood vessels do. And that's what you have to think about is the future with respect to that.
It sounds like you're at a point where you don't quite know what direction you want to go in your life. And I think that when you find that direction, that's the thing that's going to motivate you. It's the thing that's going to excite you. It's the thing that's going to make you want to get out of bed for, kind of yeah. thing. So I think you're kind of at a crossroads in terms of really finding what's important to me and what do I really want to do. One of the things that sometimes drives us or motivates us is avoidance. And we end up avoiding ourselves and avoiding our own feelings and emotions. And right. And so as you begin to face some of those feelings and acknowledge them and process them out, then those are going to stop being barriers for you. They kind of act like anchors and hold us back, but when you can face those feelings, then you're going to feel a lot freer in moving forward.
The word I think of when I look at Raquel is brave. I think Raquel has really overcome a lot in the last number of years in her life, and I really respect that. I think she's a very, very brave young lady. This is going to be a road that you're going to travel, and there are going to be speed bumps in the road. There's going to be a little uphill. There's going to be a little downhill, and what you have to do is you have to rely upon, for lack of a better term, a team of individuals to help you out, and that team of individuals is going to be your family, your friends, nutritionists, physicians, psychologists, people like that, and realize that this is not something that you're going to walk away from, you know, and it's over. You're going to battle. But you're a battler, and I think you're going to do very, very well.
Cool. Good to know.
What I gather is that you seem to have a strong need to please everyone around you. And when you don't get others' approval, then you feel like you've let others down. And then that eventually leads to perhaps feeling like you've let yourself down. And then you kind of go downhill from there. You end up feeling like I'm not good enough. And then you can get very critical of yourself. And all of this impacts your self-worth, your worth, your feelings about yourself as a person. And so that's one thing that I think will be an important issue for you to address is learning to lighten up on yourself and realize that, you know, you're okay just the way you are. You don't have to be perfect. And when things happen, you can kind of dust yourself off and move on with life.
I would approach your future really in a very simple way, and that's the one day at a time approach. I'm going to get up today, and today's going to be a good day. I'm going to eat healthy, I'm going to exercise, I'm going to feel good about myself, and then you know what, when I go to bed, we'll deal with tomorrow.
What do you think, guys? What can you offer after hearing all this?
I'm not Raquel.
Lisa, thank you very much for joining us while we talk to your daughter here today.
Well, Melissa is a tremendously talented, focused young lady, which are two very positive traits. I think, in general, physically, her health is very good. Your blood pressure was a little bit high, which could have been a reflection on your weight. I think that your biggest thing right now is that with the focus that you've put toward your performances and school and those type of things, you've really let some of the other more fundamental things kind of go by the wayside. In general, I think the prioritization, again, for you is extremely important, and the taking control yourself is going to be very, very important for you.
It seems like you feel just about every feeling available to mankind. One of the emotions that you filled out there that I recall in our conversation that seems to color your life is feelings of insecurity or fear. And this seems to translate into this need to be accepted, which is not bad, but if it runs your life, then that's where it can be detrimental to you. And that in turn translates into a need to be perfect. And when you're not perfect, then I imagine you get very critical about yourself and judgmental of yourself. And you get stuck with a lot of what-if thoughts, like what if I fail? What if you don't like me? What if I make a fool of myself? What will they think of me? What if I make a mistake? And so on and so forth. And often a lot of these feelings of needing to be perfect, needing other people's approval, is what translates into problems with eating, because that's often what the kinds of feelings that people eat over to try to somehow resolve in themselves. And we touched on your relationship with your mom, and it sounds like a lot of the feelings that you've developed about yourself may have grown out of your relationship with your mom, and perhaps your mom has been somewhat a little overbearing for you in your life and difficult to deal with. Perhaps. That may be something that will be important for you to deal with in your relationship with your mom in terms of moving on with your life and growing into your own person and being the person that you're meant to be in life.
Melissa, I admire you. Is there anything you feel that you want to say to your mother or get off your chest?
Well, it's not the big things, because you're really supportive and like you always tell me you're proud of me, but like the little things like, oh, you could do this, oh, you could do this, that's what really gets me. Like,
what do you mean?
Like, oh, you could have done this, but you didn't do that. There's always something more I need to do that I could have done, but I didn't do. And I think over these things in my head, but to have someone else tell me those, it's does not help at all.
Okay. And I'm sorry I'm being so critical, but sometimes you forget stuff and we're like leaving the house and I have to say, you could have done that. And maybe it's my teacherly stuff.
I know that I'm doing stuff wrong. I don't need to be reminded that I'm doing stuff wrong, because that's already going through my head a million miles per hour.
Okay. I'm hearing you.
If I could just add a little there. I mean, if that's something that's occurring between you, when you tell her what she could have done, it acts to invalidate what she has done.
Okay.
And it's kind of an inherent criticism, even though you may not be meaning it as such as a criticism. It's like on her side, she might be feeling, well, don't you recognize what I am doing?
Even when we're having like a normal day and we're going in the car to rehearsal, there's something that comes up that makes you snip at me. And
okay.
Or there's something that comes up that makes something snippy, and it just pretty much ruins the whole thing, and I can't, like, I don't know, focus as much.
So we'll just be late then, and we'll just get there.
No, I'm not saying we should be late!
Whoa, tone. See? I try to ask her, like,
you misunderstood, or she felt misunderstood in that moment, because she wasn't talking about being late.
Oh.
You said, okay, well, we'll just be late, but that's not what she was talking. She was talking about the way in which you communicate these things. It's the way in which you communicate these. Is that correct? It's not so much about the content of what's being talked about. It's how
the communicate.
It's how it's being talked about. And it sounds like in that moment, that's where the miscommunication occurs. Because She's trying to say something to you about your tone, and then you took it as it was about being late.
It's not about what's happening, it's how you say what's happening. It just ruins everything. I can handle the what, it's the how. What?
Okay. I think it's real valuable because, when it comes to communication, there's usually two levels of communication. There's the content of what's being spoken, and then there's the tone, how it's communicated. And mostly we hear the tone first, before the words.
Yeah.
You know, when teenagers can open up and be more open, it really facilitates things. And I think with parents, as parents can perhaps step back a little bit and let their children grow, and like Dr. Weiss said, to just allow them to come forth versus trying to get them to open up or get them to speak. I think things will flow a lot better.
And so if I could give you one piece of advice out of this whole thing, it's for you to regroup, take a few deep breaths, and decide what you want to do for you. Because you are a great kid, and you are not here to make other people happy. You are here for you. And it's okay to be here for you.
And, you know, one of the things is to realize that you're good enough. Just know that. You're good enough. Just how you are. Doesn't mean you're perfect. Doesn't mean you're not going to grow and expand and develop. But right now, you're good enough. You're okay just how you are and the way you are. And that you can't please everyone. The only person that you can really please, ultimately, is you. There's no one like you.
It sucks that we have to deal with this kind of stuff. It sucks that we were put up with this junk food in our school. It sucks that we have to go to McDonald's every day after school to eat. It sucks that we feel like we can't have anyone to talk to. It's awkward to talk to our parents even. We don't have to put up with it. If we don't like something, you could say it. If you feel something, you can say it. You can tell someone. And it's hard, it's awkward sometimes. It's tough to be honest. But it feels better and stuff will get done.
A lot of the Melissa stuff got to me more than my own stuff did, because it's kind of like looking in a mirror of like, hey, this is my mom, this is me, this is probably every girl, teenage girl ever.
I feel a lot better about stuff now, and I really do. I do.
I'm gonna try to get off energy drinks and just see how it works out and just see if I can skate and surf and snowboard with the energy that, like, natural energy, or have orange or something like that.
Practically every, like, fast food place is just crap, so it's really hard to find, like, good places to go eat, or, like, it's a lot harder to, like, stay at home and make myself, like, a sandwich. It's not really that hard, but it's harder than going to McDonald's and going through the drive-thru.
I guess I'm really not like a priority to myself, and that sucks. That really does suck.
I know I'll be able to move on and get over it and make everything better and stuff. I know we will, but it might be a long, difficult journey, but it'll get there. I know it will. It'll get there. I know it will.
You actually have to make more of an effort to eat healthier, and I've actually been doing that.
You know, I just want to be healthy and don't want to die young or anything. I just want to live the healthiest life I can.
But I think we're good. I think we're really good.
The most important thing you can give a child is love. Love for their unique beingness. Not love because they were the star athlete or to get the highest grades, because then that's conditional love. Love for their own unique beingness. And therefore, the child blossoms with a tremendous amount of self-esteem. The people with self-esteem have the most health, have the most success. When you eat well, you have enough brains, energy, and intelligence to follow your heart, because you don't get sucked in. You don't get dumbed down.
We're all creatures of habit,
right.
Like it or not. You look at your day, you know, you get up in the morning, the same foot touches the ground, you use the toothbrush the same way, you shower the same way, you do everything the same. Why not introduce good exercise and nutrition into that?
Works for me.
Good.
I mean, obviously. you can see the results here, Dr. Weiss.
You're ripped.
You kids are the ones that should start telling the industry to produce the portions and to balance what they prepare. You should go to the movie theater manager and say, stop being crazy.
Yeah.
Don't attract us here with that. Give us quality.
I'm very encouraged right now that we're seeing a counter movement. We're seeing now people starting to say, gosh, you know what? What I eat directly affects what kind of a food system we're going to have, what kind of a world we're going to have.
This is an opportunity, though, for kids to stand up and say, we deserve better.
Because I want to make sure that as I move forward in this world, that I'm going to have, you know, clean water to drink, clean air to breathe, healthy communities to live in.
So it's all about choice, then?
It's all about choice.
Take charge of your own health. Don't just act in accordance with what they tell you to do. Start thinking for yourself. Your body is something that you're going to have to live with for the rest of your life. So if you take charge and you start making informed decisions and being a skeptical consumer, is not believing all those ads, then you will be much better off in the long run.
Most people are born original. Most people die copies. Choose to live as an original and to die as an original. And the way we do it is to follow our heart.